go. Let's give it up for Krista. So, I live in a house divided. Now, most of my kids have a good head on their shoulders, and my wife, we're all Gator fans. But we have this one renegade son in our household, Donald, who is a Miami Hurricane fan. Now, I know we let him off the hook because he's been corrupted at a very young age, and the Gatorade family continues to corrupt him to this day. But when football season comes around and we're getting ready to celebrate together that college football season, all of us will be in one room with our Gator jerseys on, our blue and orange. We're saying, come on, Gators, get up and go. Well, Donald's in the next room saying, it's all about the U. I live in a house divided. In fact, I live in a house where we have six women and four men. This is a house divided. Okay? At one point in our home, we had four teenage girls under one roof. Talk about a house divided. There were certain times of the month where we actually wanted to move out and go live somewhere else. We have very little control over the furniture, whether it changes from one place to another, or the colors of the walls on a daily basis. Furthermore, I live in a house divided. I live in a blended family. So we have children from different lineages, different parentages coming together under our roof, and so there can be triangulation, there can be manipulation, there can be fist fights, there can be all kinds of division. We live in a house divided. So how do we sustain our love for each other and be one unified house with all these differences, with all these preferences, with all these divisions? How do we as a church be one and operate in love and unity, even though we may have many different folks with many different preferences? For Jesus tells us that a house divided shall not stand. Grab your Bibles, we're going to need it this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. It is a light unto our path. It is a mirror that shows us who we are. It's a revelation, oh God, that shows us who you are. And so we pray this would not be simply time of just another church service, but we come humbly seeking an encounter with you. We ask that you would cause these words to burst forth from their ink cage and live and dance in us in incarnate ways. And we ask, O Holy Spirit, that you would give us the strength to not simply be hearers of the word only, but doers also. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. He's got that crazy look in his eye again. He's going to do it. I can tell. He's going to do it. Do you realize that he might be crazy? He might be a lunatic. He might be possessed by some demon. Doesn't he know that the religious people can kill him? Doesn't he know that they can destroy him? He's going to do it again. He's got that look in his eye. He's going to heal that person. You know, I wonder if the disciples ever had those kind of questions as they were following Jesus. See, Mark's story launches with trajectory and force. It's in-breaking, it's unstoppable, it's relentless good news. And already in the first three chapters of the gospel, we've seen Jesus in several confrontations and conflicts with the church folks, with the religious establishment. Again and again, you could almost name the first couple chapters of the book, Jesus versus the church people. And so we see again and again these kind of conflicts, so that when we get to the third chapter of the Gospel of Mark, the religious leaders have already decided that Jesus must die. And this morning we encounter a very different Jesus than perhaps some of us grew up with. This is not your mama's Jesus. Maybe like me, you grew up with a Caucasian Jesus on your Sunday school room, you know, with blonde hair and blue eyes, just gently carrying the lamb, you know, kind of docile and gentle. But I want to challenge you as we go through the journey of Mark together to deconstruct all those false assumptions that you have about Jesus, and to see the Jesus that Mark actually tells us about.
Yeah.
To read the Bible for what it really actually says about
right.
Jesus.
Yes.
And we might find a very renegade, kind of wild, untamed rabbi than the one maybe we grew up with in Sunday school class. You see, sometimes we create Jesus in our own image.
That's right.
We create our buddy Jesus, or our Jesus is my boyfriend kind of theology that goes around in the church, right? But I want you to encounter this Jesus that Mark presents to us. And in the third chapter, there's a situation where they go down to the synagogue to worship. They're in the church house. And Jesus sees a man with a withered hand.
That's right.
Oh, thank God. Hallelujah that Jesus sees the broken ones. Thank you that God sees us in our affliction and in our need. And just a little side note. So in the ancient world, if you had a withered hand or some kind of deformity or some kind of illness, it was because God had cursed you. That was the theology of the day, that if you were poor or if you were oppressed, if you had some kind of situation in your life, if you had an issue of blood or if you had a withered hand, the theology that Jesus is in constant conflict against is that God had made you that way because you had sinned or somehow your parents had sinned to put you in that condition. But Jesus sees the man with a withered hand that the religious establishment doesn't see.
Yes.
Because technically he is cursed. Now, the Pharisees and the scribes, Jesus sees the man with the withered hand, but their focus is on Jesus. They're watching Jesus, but why? They're watching to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. They are watching Jesus, not because they have any kind of concern or any kind of care for this man with the withered hand. They're simply watching to see if Jesus will break their rules and their regulations to heal this man. They're watching Jesus. Jesus is watching the man with the withered hand so that they might accuse him. Notice that already in the Gospel of Mark, third chapter, they've already decided that Jesus is not their Messiah. He's not the Savior they've been waiting for. And so they're looking for a way to trap him and accuse him. And so he says to the man with the withered hand, "Come forward." And when Jesus does that, the disciples are going, "Oh no, here he goes again. He's got that crazy look in his eye again. He's going to do it." Right in front of the religious leaders. Does he know that they can kill him, that they want to destroy him, that they have the power to take his life? And then Jesus says to them, "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? To take life, to save life, or to kill?" Jesus asked the question, what's more important, your rules, your regulations, your preferences, or to unleash the explosive love of God in somebody's life? What's more important, to care for somebody who's in a place of brokenness or to follow regulations and rules?
Yes, that's right.
And they are silent. They're just waiting for Jesus to trap himself in this situation. And he looked around at them with anger.
Yeah.
And the word there is arge in the Greek. It literally is anger. Now, a lot of theologians, a lot of Bible scholars, they have to do backflips around this, especially biblical literalist kind of people, right? Because they say, well, Jesus says in another place that if you've even looked at a person with anger in your heart, you've already committed murder, you're already guilty of sin. So Jesus can't possibly be feeling anger. I mean, can he? See, sometimes we make Jesus so much God that we forget that he's human. He's the fully human, fully God-man of Nazareth, fully human in every way and fully God in every way. He goes through the entire human experience just like we do. He goes through the stages of puberty and development. He has to eat and to walk and to talk and to grow just like we do. He experiences the range of human emotions like all human beings do. He weeps when Lazarus dies. He feels that emotion. He weeps over Jerusalem and he sees the reprobate nature of the people's hearts. He experiences joy. He laughs with his disciples. He experiences brokenheartedness when he sees people in need. He's the fully human, fully God-man. And in this situation, he's experiencing what the text calls a arge, anger. He's mad, y'all. When he goes into the temple and he turns over tables and runs people out with a whip in his hand, what do you call that? You got to get pretty creative to not say that that's anger when he says, "This is my Father's house," and you've turned it into a den of thieves or a business or a corporation.
Yes.
Now, we can say that what Jesus is experiencing is righteous indignation. We can experience it as just explosive love. But he's looking at the hearts of these people, and he's angry because of their hardness of heart. The word here is prosis cardia, hardness of heart. So this is a biblical theme that we see throughout the Old and the New Testament. So remember, Pharaoh hardens his heart against God and says, I'll not let the people go. Then he fights God. He goes 12 rounds with this God, Yahweh of Israel. We see hardness of heart when the Israelites are wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years, and God gives them water from a rock and manna from heaven and quail from the sky, and yet they're hard-hearted. We see the people are hard-hearted when they reject the prophets and stone and kill them. We see people are hard-hearted when they're stiff-necked and they refuse to repent and turn their lives back to God. And in this situation, we see the condition that is described in the hearts of the religious leaders is their hardness of heart. We might say, well, what is that? But what does hardness of heart actually mean? Well, the heart, the cardia, is the soul, the seat of the soul, the seat of the emotional life and the intellect. It's kind of the essence, the core of who we are as human beings. And Jesus describes them at their core, at the very center of who they are, as hardness. See, the religious leaders, they know all the right things. They know all the right answers. They know the creeds. They know the songs. They know the scriptures. But the long journey from their head to their heart, that 12-inch journey, has never taken place. They've forgotten that the center of the faith is not about rules and regulations, but the Shema, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And in their hardness of heart, they no longer have compassion or concern or any care at all for the afflicted or the broken or the hungry or the sick or the oppressed. It's all about them. It's all about their rules and their regulations. It's all about their religiosity and their preferences and the way that they do things. And because of that, and because of their hardness of heart, they have no concern or care or compassion for anybody. They're even about to kill their Messiah.
Oh, no.
And Jesus is angry at the condition of their hearts.
Yes.
And so he says to the man, stretch out your hand.
Wow.
And the disciples go, oh no, he's going to do it. Does he know that we might lose our lives in this situation? And the man stretches out his hand, and it's healed.
That's right.
Now Jesus doesn't technically do anything except say, stretch out your hand, and it's healed, but the Pharisees immediately conspire with the Herodians, which is this political group who's allied with Herod, and they say, we must destroy Jesus. He's a threat to our religious establishment. He's a threat to our power. And so already in the third chapter of the Gospel of Mark, they have decided that Jesus Christ must die. And so what we see in this text is a house divided. It's a religious house divided. The very people that are waiting for a Messiah expectantly to come are rejecting the very one that God has sent. In the next situation, we see a house divided, even among the disciples, where some are in or some are out. We see one, even among the disciples, who's committed to betray Jesus. And then in the next situation, we see a house divided even in the family of Jesus, who some of his own family members are saying that he's crazy, he's mad, he's demon-possessed. So in the next situation here, there's this multitude of people that come down from the sea to hear Jesus and to experience Jesus. There's so many people that they don't even have time to eat. And Jesus has to get back in a boat to preach to them so that he doesn't get crushed. And the demons begin to proclaim that he's the Son of God. Who are the first people to rightfully acknowledge who Jesus is? It's not the disciples. They don't get it pretty much through the whole story. It's not the religious leaders. They reject Jesus and they kill him. It's the demons. The demons say, what do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? This is the Son of God. They know all the right things. They know who Jesus is and they believe and they shudder.
That's right.
But that doesn't mean they follow him.
That's right.
That doesn't mean that they're his disciples, right?
Amen.
So here's these crowds of people that come down, they're listening, and then Jesus draws back and he takes the ones, the text tells us, that he calls to himself, the ones that he has chosen. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to be in that group that gets called up to the mountain of Jesus. Amen. So what is it that separates this multitude, this great crowd of people, from the ones who Jesus called up onto the mountain with himself? And we can really boil it down to one word. Commitment. Commitment. You see, people come to see Jesus for all kinds of reasons.
Yes.
Some of them come to see the spectacle. Some of them come for selfish reasons. They want a healing or they want something from Jesus. Some people come to church because it's what they've always done, or they're just following the crowd and they hear that something cool is going on, or there's some kind of show and they want to see it. But then there's those who are committed. There's those who are all in. The ones that Jesus calls up onto the mountain with himself are people that exemplify a commitment level and certain values. And we see the disciples living by and being taught kingdom values. And they look like this: prayers, presence, gifts, service, witness, and they rally around the word. So the disciples are people of prayer. They're living a prayerful life. They're learning the life of prayer that Jesus is teaching them. And this is how you pray when you get down on your knees and you talk to Abba, Daddy God, our Father who art in heaven. They're learning to rest and reflect and retreat with Jesus, to go back to those concentrated times of prayer. They're people who bring their presence. They are all in with Jesus. They are there every step of the way. They're there every time the church doors are open. They're going to be with Jesus no matter what. These are people that bring their gifts. They don't bring 10%, y'all. They bring 100%. They put all their resources on the Jesus table. These are the ones who leave behind families and lucrative careers and businesses to follow after Jesus. They bring everything that they have, their gifts. These are people who not just come up to the mountain because Jesus has no concern or no care about the great multitudes of people, but Jesus is doing ministry by multiplication. He's doing ministry by a team-based ministry. So he's preparing the disciples and instilling these values in them, and then he's sending them out to be his witnesses. So literally, in the authority and the kingdom power of Jesus himself, he sends them out as an extension of his ministry, as his apostello, his sent ones, to be his witnesses. From Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the ends of the earth, they are supposed to embody the very life of Jesus and the love of God in the world. And these are people who bring their service. Jesus teaches them the pattern of servanthood. Jesus gets down on his hands and knees and he washes their feet. He says, "The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. But now that I have done this for you, I want you to wash each other's feet." He teaches them the value of servanthood, and he sends them out to be servants of the oppressed and the broken, the lost and the least in the world. And finally, they are people who rally around the living word that is Jesus Christ. And they study the scriptures together. And Jesus shows them and teaches them to obey everything that I have taught you when he sends them out, right? And he shows them how all the scriptures are fulfilled in the person of Jesus and how each portion of scripture points prophetically to him. These are people who live by kingdom values. They're all in. They're committed to the Jesus movement. And then Jesus sends them out to the crowds in the world. The next situation we see, Jesus is doing his ministry and his own family comes and they say, "What is wrong with Jesus? He's passing himself off as some kind of Messiah. Is he demon possessed? Is he crazy? Is he a lunatic? We know Jesus. He grew up 30 years in a little hole in the wall town with Nazareth as a carpenter's son. And here he is doing all these healings and great multitudes of people are coming out to see him." And the religious leaders say, "It's by Beelzebub, the Lord of flies, the prince of demons, that Jesus is casting out demons." And in that context, Jesus says, "Can a house divided stand? Can a kingdom that's divided stand? Why would Satan cast out Satan? Why would demons do damage to the power of demons? Why would a kingdom be divided against itself?" Right? But Jesus says, "No, you bind up the strong man so that you can go in and plunder the kingdom of darkness."
That's
right. Jesus said, "It doesn't make any sense that the devil would drive out devils, right? But one who's greater than the devil has come. One who's greater than the prince and the power of the earth and the air has bound up the strong man, and his name is Jesus Christ." And Jesus has already won the victory. He's already put a whipping on the devil. He's already defeated all the consequences of sin and evil and death. He's been resurrected from the dead, the death-conquering master of all. He's ascended to the throne of heaven where he sits and reigns and rules, and he's Lord over all the universe. He's Lord over you, and he's Lord over me. He's Lord of all human societies because Jesus has come and defeated the plans of the enemy on the cross and through his resurrection. Now we can live into that victory. Can I get an amen? your sins will be forgiven you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Because of what Jesus has done in his work at the cross and his resurrection, all your sins will be forgiven you. Just camp out on that for a minute. All your sins are forgiven. Every mistake you've ever made, every bad thought you've ever had, every argument you've ever had, every evil, twisted thing you've ever done, Jesus says all your sins are forgiven. See, now we're the only ones that drag those back up, right? God's committed to forgive. God's committed to forget. We're the ones who live in guilt and shame and like it's not already been forgiven, right? Like he's not already cast our sins as far as the east is from the west into the sea of forgetfulness, right? We're the ones who bring those back up. But Jesus said, all your sins are forgiven you except one. Blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is the unpardonable sin. Now, if you're sitting there asking yourself, oh, Lord, what is that? And I hope I didn't commit it. Right? And if you're thinking that, you probably haven't committed it. Because I think this connects back to the hardness of heart. What is blasphemy against the Holy Spirit? Well, in this context, the religious folks, the people who are God-following people, are attributing to the devil the things that God is doing. The Holy Spirit is transforming people's lives and turning their world right side up, and they're attributing it to demonic spirits. God's kingdom and reign have broken into the world in the person of Jesus Christ, and they're calling Jesus the devil, Beelzebub. Because in their hardness of heart, they no longer have any concern or care for people in a place of need. And so now they're attributing the very things that God is doing to Satan. And I don't think that God will not forgive us for that. I think that there's really no sin that God won't forgive us for.
Amen.
But I think that when we find ourselves in that state, in that hardness of heart, we have forcefully removed ourselves from the grace of God. We have forcefully called the things that God is doing evil and satanic and demonic. And by doing that, we literally pull ourselves away. We refuse God's grace because of our hardness of heart. Because that connection has been lost and our compassion and our love is dead. Jesus says, all your sins will be forgiven you except blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. And in this final scene, Jesus is there gathered with his disciples. And his family shows up, his brothers and sisters. And they say, hey Lord, your family's here. Your brothers and sisters are here. They want to see you. And Jesus says, who is my family? Who are my brothers and sisters? He says, those of you that are sitting in this room are my brothers and sisters. Those of you that are committed, those of you who are being obedient to God, those of you who are following me, you are my brothers and my sisters. Those that are exemplifying those kingdom values of prayers, presence, gifts, service, witness, and rallying around God's word, you are my family. See, the kingdom that Jesus proclaims, our analogy that blood is thicker than water, is false. For Jesus teaches us that water is thicker than blood. In Jesus, we have a community and a family that's more powerful and more relevant even than our flesh and blood family. For it's through the grace-filled waters of our baptism that God has claimed us. It's through the waters of our baptism that we've been brought into this big, messy, jacked up family called the church.
Amen.
It's through the waters of our baptism that God has said, this one is mine. He's given us a new identity and a new mission and a new name and a new purpose in the earth. It's through the waters of our baptism, through the love of God, that he's claimed us as his own and brought us into a new community, unified by the power of the Holy Spirit under the lordship of Jesus Christ. And so if we are in Jesus through the waters of our baptism, we are family, and water is thicker than blood. Jesus said, you are my family. My disciples are my family. See, folks, our church is not a house divided. We might all have differences. We might all have different preferences. Some of us might have tattoos. Some of us might not. Some of us might like to worship with drums and guitars. And some of us might like to worship with organs and a choir. But we are one family.
Amen.
unified under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Some of us might like to wear blue and orange, and some of us might like to wear green and orange, but we are one family unified under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Some of us might like to sit in pews with hymnals in our hands, and some of us might like to sit around tables with breakfast, but we are one family under the Lordship of Jesus Christ, because it's through our commitment to Him. It's through the waters of our baptism that we've been brought and made into one family. You see, I live in a house divided.
Amen.
I've got a renegade son who loves the Hurricanes, but I still love him.
Amen.
I live in a house divided. The women try to rule in our house, and it causes division.
Woo!
But I still love him. I live in a house divided, a blended family with different children, with different preferences, from different experiences coming together. Sometimes it's messy, sometimes there's triangulation, but we all love each other. And in our family, we are committed to be one family, and it's the love that we have for each other that binds us together, and we're a family that operates by values. So we sat down together, and we hammered out this document together. That has all of our values, and everybody contributed into that document, from Angel all the way up, and we said, what are our family values as the Beck family? So we came up with things like love, and helpfulness, and creativity, and integrity. We put all those things on paper. Then we developed our family mission statement. What is the purpose of our family that God has in the world? And then we developed our boundaries. What are the things that are unacceptable in our family? What are the things that we don't do, or there will be repercussions? And then we develop this thing that we call the Beck Family Creed. And within that creed, we say things like, you're a large, blended Christian family. One piece of that creed says that only the sounds of love will come from our home. And so when there's division and when there's triangulation, we point to the creed, right? When there's a Miami Hurricane and a Gator having a fist fight, and we go, no, 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 only the sounds of love will come from our home. When there's a step-brother, sister, sibling rivalry going on, we say, no, only the sounds of love will come from our home. When we're going through situations and there's different preferences and things are happening and a fist fight happens over a cookie or a brownie, we say, no, 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 only the sounds of love will come from our home. And church, it's my hope that we will be a church that only the sounds of love will come from this home.
Amen.
It's my hope that when somebody's bad-mouthing or critiquing or talking about the pastors or talking about they don't like this new arrangement or talking about they don't like this worship experience, it's my hope that you'll stand up and go, no, 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 only the sounds of love will come from this home. When somebody's gossiping or somebody's promulgating some kind of false thing, it's my hope that you'll stand up and say, no, 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 only the sounds of love will come from this home. When somebody's divided and talking about, well, this person gets more care than this person and those people over there and this and that, I want you to stand up and say, no, only the sounds of love will come from Wildwood United Methodist Church. Because a house divided cannot stand. And so maybe some of us like the Hurricanes, maybe some of us like the Gators, maybe some of us like to worship in the 1950s style, maybe some of us like to worship in the 1980s style, but we are one family called together under the Lordship of Jesus Christ and unified by the power of the Holy Spirit, and we've been brought together through our commitment level and our values.
Amen.
See, here's the good news. None of you are the multitude who just show up to see the show. None of you are like those crowds who are just coming along to see what the Jesus thing is all about, right? You're committed. You stood up on the altar and you made a commitment to this church and to Jesus Christ, and you said, I will honor this church with my prayers, my presence, my gifts, my service, my witness. You said, I will be here for worship. I will pray for my church and my community and my ministers. I will show up at Bible study and I will study God's word. I will tithe faithfully. I will bring what God has given me and blessed me with, and I will give it back to God in a sacrificial way. You made the commitment to be a witness in our community to Jesus Christ. You made a commitment to be a servant in our community for Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
He's called you up to the mountain. And He's called you His own. He's called you His own family. Right? A house divided cannot stand. A community that's divided by a railroad track with white people on one side and black on the other cannot stand.
Amen.
That's why it breaks my heart when I hear some of our people say, oh, we don't need to be doing that over there. We don't need to be doing the multiracial thing. They've got their churches, their problems, and we've got ours. No! That's a lie from the depths of hell.
Amen.
That's not God's vision for community, but we should be one.
Yes.
Right? And so we've got to continue this relationship and continue doing the things that we're doing and worshiping in each other's churches and coming together in unity, because only the sounds of love will come from Wildwood, Florida. And we can stand up and we can be different. We can be a sign and a symbol to the nations that God is doing something in little Wildwood, Florida. A nation divided cannot stand. A nation that's divided by political parties cannot stand. A nation where a corporatocracy, where God is no longer in the throne of America, but dollar signs, cannot stand. And folks, I hate to break it to you, but the hope of our nation is not predicated upon the next presidential candidate. Thank God. The hope of our nation is predicated upon the Lordship of Jesus Christ and His love and His principles and His church and His return of Him coming soon. The only hope that we have as a nation in a world is placed firmly in the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Can I get an amen this morning?
Amen.
For a house divided cannot stand. And every time we come down to this table, we are reminded that water is thicker than blood. It's through the sacrifice that Jesus has given, and it's through our baptism into the community of faith that we've been called one big blended family. And when we come to this table, we remember that we are unified with all the Christians who've ever been or ever will be, with all our distinctions and all our differences and all our preferences, we come together as one. And it's at this table where we acknowledge and we repent and we say, God, we have not been as committed as we should be. We have not been faithful in our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and at times we have even been those Pharisees who've been hard-hearted to the needs of others. We come to this table and we repent, and we ask God to infuse His grace into our life afresh. And the good news is this morning that if you're willing to do that, there's room at this table for you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Amen.